Havilah here. How you doing? Hey, I thought I'm gonna clean up my little screen. I thought I would jump on for a few minutes and talk about our boundary series. Are you guys loving it? I hope that you are loving the series. We've had such incredible responses. And let me see. If you are just jumping on, we're in the private Facebook group right now, and I thought I would just kind of check in with you guys. We are getting closer to the end. We are now halfway through. We're almost at the end, and now, not almost at the end, but we're getting closer to the end. And we have heard such phenomenal things about boundaries. And I love watching you guys and everything that's happening. I'm hearing words like life-changing, and I've been a leader for many years and I've never heard this. Or one of the posts we got was, I'm taking my 9-year-old daughter through boundaries, and she came home and told me that she used her no today and she felt really powerful. And another friend of mine said that she's in leadership at her church and she's never had this kind of teaching before, and it's revolutionizing her life. And so, woo, I'm also back in my chair. So I want to know if you're on here, will you say hi for a minute? There's like 20 of us right now, and I'm only going to take about 10 minutes. So don't worry, this is not a forever Insta Live, but I thought I would answer any questions you might have about boundaries, or what has stood out to you the most with our I Do Boundaries study. I would love, love, love to know. There is no wrong answer. I'd just like to check in. You know, yesterday we talked about boundaries with our bodies, which I thought was really important. I got a lot of good feedback. We don't often look at boundaries as a physical thing, like taking care of ourselves as having a healthy boundary. And I started learning that my bedtimes were sacred. My rest was sacred. You know, there's a reason why God did, He created for 6 days. On the seventh day, He rested, right? So, hi, everybody. I see Kathy's here, Gio's here, and Nicole's here. My mom is here. I love you, Mom. Let's see. Rochelle is here. Raquel, I guess. Your book has changed my life. So, tell me, how has it changed your life? I want to know. We want to know. What has spoken to you, and then maybe a question you might have, I would love to answer. If you are open, I would love that as well. I know I'm putting you on the spot, but I thought I'd give you just a minute to talk about it. One thing that I think we start getting into with boundaries is, okay, how do I get everybody to start participating with my boundaries, especially my spouse? Did you start thinking about that when we started talking about boundaries, or did you start thinking about your family? I know that my mom is on here and she knows that when I started learning about boundaries, I would come home and like preach to my family about boundaries. And what I didn't realize was that boundaries was an internal work. It was a confidence that I had to grow in to be able to communicate what was okay around me and what I was going to allow to be around me. So it has been, I hope it's been eye-opening. Let's see. Gio says, I have never had boundaries. Exactly. Sherry, this is the study is the best I've ever done. Thank you. That means a lot. Have you guys done an Amazon review yet? That sounds so like a luxurious request. But please, if this speaks to you and you've enjoyed the study, I implore you, please go to Amazon and write a review. It's the only way people find the book, and it's the only way that keeps our numbers up so that it goes on people's lists when they start searching for Bible studies. So please, hi Houston. Okay, Raquel says, my question is about when you try to set boundaries with someone and they always say they feel controlled. Excellent. Well, the reason they feel controlled is because you probably are trying to control them a little. And so, what we want to do, I'm teasing, I'm teasing. What we want to do is we need to understand that an irresponsible person or somebody who's used to you doing what they want you to do, they're going to say something that wants to trigger you so that you'll go back and get back in line and do the thing that you always did, which might have been enable them or be available to them 24 hours a day, or maybe just hear about all their problems all the time. So, what you have to understand is you almost have to see that they are the 2-year-old that's saying, I want milk now. I want to go outside now. And they're throwing a tantrum. And but we get really smart at tantrums as adults. We don't say things like, you're mean and I don't like you and I want to. We say things like, you're very controlling, or you're triggering me, or you think you're better than me, or you're using me. These are verbiage that we use to get people in our lives to do what we want them to do. And so I want you to understand that this verbiage, whoever is saying this to you, knows it will trigger you. And what they know is that when you use that verbiage, you will fall back into line, because now they know that when they use the word control, that's it. But secondly, let's look at the other side of that, because there's always two sides to the coin. So it might be that they're trying to get you to do a specific thing, but there could be a part of you that is coming off controlling. And see, this is the disconnect with boundaries. And I hope you're doing the study, Raquel, I'm sure that you are, but the disconnect is, I get to, now that I have boundaries, I get to tell everybody what to do and where to go and how to do it, because I need this to be organized and controlled, right? But the important part about walking out healthy boundaries is 99.9% of boundaries is you. It's your narrative internally, and it's what you allow around you without words. It really is a lot like that. So what you want to do is realize if they're saying you're controlling, then just chalk it up as, okay, that's their word that usually gets me to respond. But secondly, am I asking them to do something? Am I asking them to respond so that I can be powerful? And if I am, then I am being controlling. I can be under control and be powerful while you're out of control and living in chaos. Your response and reaction says nothing about me, and my response and reaction says nothing about you. You feel controlled? Well, I can't make you feel controlled. That's something you've decided that you're going to feel right now. Now, you might say, you're trying to control me, but I will not be controlled. Or I see that. Yeah, that you're trying to manipulate me, but I'm not going to be manipulated. But the truth is, it still says everything about them, because they are feeling like powerless to your boundary. And so I want you to really ask yourself, is it that they are trying to trigger you, to manipulate you, or is it that you're coming off controlling because you're new at this, you're not sure how to say it, or you're just being a bully with your boundaries and you got to pull back and go, you know what, I need to learn to say it in a nicer way and give space for people to disagree with me, but for me not to change my answer, but not to lecture, not to ridicule, not to chastise people, but just to be. Does that make sense? That's an excellent question. So Gio says, would say yes to everything, especially church. And when having five kiddos, it was liberating to hear you say, it's okay to put my family first. Yes. And amen. Listen, I remember when my Christian counselor said to me, you are allowed to say no because you're putting your family first. And I'm telling you, I didn't know that. I didn't even know I was allowed to do that. I thought that God would take care of them. And, you know, like Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, you know, let other people bury them. You know, you come follow me. And I was taught that that's what good faith looks like. But I think it was eye-opening when my counselor said to me, when Jesus said, go into all the earth, he was saying to you, Havilah, to go into your living room, to your congregation of four. And that was sobering and humbling and liberating to know that I could make my kids dinner and be home, and there's 100 people worshiping down the street, but that I was doing the holy and worthy thing too. And, you know, I could go and do something churchy and go do this moment, or I could go on a date night, and I was actually treating what was most important to me sacred, because I was building the covenantal relationship that I had given myself to. Does that make sense? So you're going to have to rework some of your thinking and process, but I promise you, you will see a huge reward. Remember, you want to minister and give out of the overflow of your life. So when you have littles in the home at 18 and under, you're looking for a surplus to give to other people, but your family needs your very best. And so I'm not saying like I have a job. I'm not talking about that you have to lose yourself for your family. There's a whole kind of pendulum that people swing to, but I'm talking about that I'm allowed to choose my family. I'm allowed to choose sleep. I'm allowed to choose date nights. I'm allowed to choose bedtimes. And that is all sacred and holy before God, because this is my stewardship. And the Bible says, in whatever you do, do it unto him. So it's not when you do this, That's doing it under him. There is no sacred and secular line. Everything is sacred to God if it's something he's called you into. So relax. You might feel like, well, I feel like I'm going to like not, I'm going to miss opportunity and I'm going to be at home and I'm going to miss what God has. You will a little, meaning you may have to on-ramp later and realize, wow, I could have been spending my time doing that. But you know what? It's all about priorities. When you get your priorities right, it doesn't matter. You'll go, you know what? That those people got to do all those things and that's wonderful and that's what God called them to do. But right now I did the holy thing and I look back and I have no regrets. I gave myself to those that needed me the most and I protected that which matters the most. I can say it. So slow down and live in the overflow. Right. So here's the question I would ask. If you're a mom or a dad and you have kids under, in a very juvenile toddler infant stage, my question would be to you, do you have surplus to give to somebody else or are you giving out of need? And my concern for you is the only person that's going to pay the price for your exhaustion, your anxiety, your lack of clarity, your sickness is your family. Church people aren't going to pay that sacrifice. Your kids are. So ask yourself, if I do this, who's going to pay the price for that? My spouse, my kids, my help? And ask yourself that and then begin to give yourself permission. And you have to stop looking at it as, I wish I could do all that, but I can't. What if instead of us going, I can't, this is good and this is bad, what if we just said, I've chosen to be more obedient to God in this season. And that obedience looks like taking care of my mind, taking care of my heart, taking care of my body, taking care of my relationships, taking care of my kids, taking care of my friendships, taking care of my finances. Like, what if we just said, I'm going to do the healthy things. And instead of looking at like some, you know, quick reward by being at everything and doing everything, instead if we could pull back and go, okay, God, I only have a little bit of time with this season of my life and I'm going to steward it so well that when I look back, I will have no regrets. Now there's a transition period and all you moms know this that have little kids that are a little older. If you don't stop going, you know, smothering them and going, I can't, there's going to be a season when it's no, 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 yes. And for some of you, you've gotten stuck in the no, 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 and you're realizing your kids don't need you and yet you don't have anywhere to go because you got stuck saying no. So I want you this season, your boundary is to stop saying no to the fear of not having enough. And your boundary is to say, I can say a powerful yes because I have more than enough time, more than enough resource, more than enough energy. And I can give out of my need because no one's going to pay for it at home. And I get to give that way. Yeah. Okay. Let's see. Naomi says, I get concerned when stay-at-home moms stop learning and growing because they are at home, their kids pay the price when we stop learning spiritually. I agree with you. And I've seen a lot of people that are also working moms that stop growing and stop learning too. So I don't think you can just throw a label on it. It is about your personal journey to do the right thing and to grow and to be. And I agree with you, you know, don't lose yourself in your kids, but also don't use your kids to keep your life going, right? We got to have a good balance. Suzanne says, I'm single and do not have children. Can you speak to boundaries for those in this season of life? Yes, excellent question. And I love this question because you need boundaries and you are going to have to really figure this out because you want to get your needs met in a healthy way. And as a single man or woman, the Bible says it is the best way to live. I know it doesn't feel that way in a world that's obsessed with marriage and weddings and all those things, but you get to keep your focus where you want it to be. And so I think what's really important is boundaries are just because I'm single doesn't mean I'm always available. Just because I'm single doesn't mean I should have to do everything that the married people can't. Just because I'm single doesn't make me a second-class citizen in the kingdom, nor lack value, or somehow need to be at everything, doing everything. You need to ask yourself, when is my heart fully alive, and how do I set my choices up and my boundaries and my core values where I'm allowed to fight for me, and it is not selfish, and it is not narcissistic, and it is not needy. You know, as a single woman, and you know this, Suzanne, it's tricky. You know, you're looking at one friend friendship for your movie date friend, and another friendship for your vacation, and another friendship for, you know, a church or whatever. And that sometimes requires even more energy because you're finding people to do things with. And so give yourself grace and realize that you don't have more time than married people or people that have kids. You have a different set of needs, and all of those needs require each of us to invest a healthy amount of time in the yeses and the nos in our lives. Excellent question. All right, Stephanie Warner says, I learned so much. Thank you, appreciate that so much. I'm just any mom who has a lot going on, maybe anybody. Yep, totally agree. And I love that thought that you said, Naomi. Okay, my kids are teens. I've had to learn not to push my son spiritually and let God take control of him and his beliefs. Yes, and amen, Jessica. My eldest is 14. I'll tell you what, isn't it tricky? Because what we want to do is we want to control their yard, right? We're talking about this in the boundary series, but within my yard are my feelings, choices, and attitudes. And when our kids are under 18, they're in our yard too. So we're like, that's what you should feel about that. That's a good feeling. That's a bad feeling. Or that's just a feeling, no moral value, but hey, you don't want to give your life to that. Or maybe it's an attitude, a thought process, or a belief system, or maybe it's a choice, and we're nurturing them and guiding them. But there's a point in the later teen years where God's beginning to take their own yard and remove it from ours, that their attitudes, choices, and feelings are theirs. And we move from parental to influential. And no matter what, even if we don't want to, that's what happens just internally as an adult. I remember this. So it's really important. And you're going to have courage to trust God. When you have teenagers, we have to trust God. I don't know about you, but within a 24-hour period, I could think everything I did didn't matter. And the next minute, I'm like, they are good kids. So whatever you're going through, we really have to remember that they see God through us. So if we're controlling and anxious and fearful, that is how they're going to filter God and how he feels and thinks about them. So the best thing we can do is have hope for their life, have faith for their future, encourage them, love them, sometimes from afar, sometimes give them godly consequences to their actions, but not give up hope, because our kids are anointed for this generation and we're anointed to parent them in this generation. Yeah. Hannah says, thanks for helping myself. And as a 29-year-old mom and wife, we are raised in different generations. I've learned so much from your videos. I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you. Honoring the true rest, not fake rest. Yes and amen. I'm stuck on trying to figure out what my property lines are and how to rebuild. Tanya, I hope you're doing the boundary lesson. So I'm sure you are because you're in this group. Take all the time you need, but I would start with the basics. Feelings, choices, and attitudes are in my yard. They are my responsibility. Start with the basics. Don't get complex. And when you think about it, is that their feeling? Is that their thought? Is that their choice? Then they get to own that. If it's mine, I get to own it. And just, you're going to have to practice. It's so difficult in the beginning. So don't feel overwhelmed. For me, it was like, I didn't realize how much I was in everybody's yard and how much I let people walk in my yard and tell me what they thought. So it takes some time, but I promise you will get there. I promise. What do I do when someone won't respect my boundaries and keeps pushing them? Then you set a standard. So you can't make someone have boundaries, but you can require an atmosphere, an environment that you're around. So if it's somebody that you realize this person's never going to respect my boundaries, then you're going to have to wean them from you. And you can't change your yes or no. If it's somebody that you think just doesn't respect it, you might have to have a come to Jesus that says, you know, I realize that in the past, I've allowed people to think and do things and say things around me that I was fearful of losing friendship. I was fearful of you thinking I was mean, but I'm learning to take care of myself. I'm learning to obey God more. And so I want you to know that when I say a few things, it's not even about you. It has nothing to do with you. It has to do with me showing up like a grown-up, finding my courage to protect what matters most to me. And I will stand before God for my life. And I'm confident of that. Remember, irresponsible people love to gaslight us into thinking that it's us. It isn't you. And a respectful, responsible person will never judge you for you being for you having boundaries, we will go, that is the appropriate thing to do. So if you don't have anybody in your life that's saying, yes, that's a good choice, or yes, that's healthy, then you're going to have to find some new friends, and that's going to take some time, but do it. Okay, guys, one last question, and then I have to go. I'm so sorry. Liz Pierce says, I had no boundaries and lived a stressful life because of the problem I had saying no. Now I'm trying to introduce boundaries in my life and no one is taking me seriously. Do I give them time to adapt to my boundaries, or do I disassociate myself from them? Liz, excellent question. So good. My thought for you is take some time to let them adjust. The only way that I can think of it is they're like addicts and they have been used to the hit. They've been used to you saying yes to everything, letting their responsibilities go into your yard. They have been letting you take their feelings on and you feeling responsible for that. You're the yes can, always do kind of woman, and they're used to it. So when you start to push back, they're like, really? Really? Like, I'm an addict. I want my hit. Come on. And so what you're going to have to do, Liz, is you're going to have to set your boundaries by following through. If someone starts to be disrespectful, then you say, you know what? I'm going to go in the other room, and when you want to be respectful, I'd be happy to continue this conversation. Or when this conversation turns respectful, I'll be happy to start that. And then you are going to have to walk out of the room. If you don't want to pay their bills, then you have to say, hey, I've come to a new conclusion that I am no longer able to pay that bill for you. So in 30 days, I'm giving you a 30-day warning, but I will not be paying that bill. Or, you know what? I am not taking phone calls after 10 o'clock at night. So I know you used to text and I'm used to picking up your phone, but I just want you to know I'm turning my phone off. I'm having a new season of getting refreshed. And then you'll have to follow through. Listen, lectures don't teach irresponsible people what you think or what you're going to do. The only way irresponsible people learn is through pain, consequence. Okay, so you're gonna have to say no, and you're gonna have to follow through. If you say you're gonna do something and you don't do it, guess what they know? You don't even believe it yourself. So you're gonna have to be clear, what are you going to allow yourself to do and what are you not? And my suggestion, Liz, is you need to sit down and you need to ask yourself some good questions like, what bothers me and where do I feel people are taking advantage of me and why do I keep losing my yes and my no? And I want you to write it down and get really clear on those situations. And then I want you to practice your response. So you have to practice. This is the text message I'm going to send when they send that to me. This is going to be my answer. And my suggestion is keep that answer brief and amazing and use phrases like, I am crystal clear. I will not be able to do that for you. Next time, make sure and you can ask me. Or, gosh, I would love to do that, but at this point, I'm only giving myself 5 things to do this season, and those 5 have already been picked. And you're going to have to follow through, even if you feel like they don't like you, they hate you, they judge you. It's okay. Those are just feelings, and you don't know what they feel because they're not telling you. And even if they tell you, it doesn't really matter. They don't get to choose why you made that choice. So you're going to have to find some courage to fight for what you need, Liz. You're worthy, and you're valuable, and you're more than your yes, and you're more than what other people want from you. You are a godly, powerful woman. And you are becoming a new creation in Christ, which means you get the power to protect what matters to you, whether anybody likes it or not. We're going to stop feeling bad about it. All right, you guys, I love you. We're on day 9. Tomorrow's day 10. We have about 5 more days of this study. Again, one thing you can do for me, please, there's like almost 100 of you on this thing right now. Please write me an Amazon review. Don't make me beg, but it's literally the one thing that would help me get the message out. I don't even need you to buy a book. I literally just need an Amazon review of the study and how it's speaking to you. An honest, like authentic review would be the biggest gift. All right, I love you guys. I'll hopefully check in with you again very soon.